We have moved at a snail's pace. And again, apologies, but this is how what you get. So, you're still up?
Any else for 2 weeks?
Bring back after getting different language, so that one has been moved to the side.
I have to clarify something.
Perfect, yes. So 5772 weapons, this is from, this policy is in regards to students possessing weapons. The changes that have been added are recommended by NEOLA. There are very few. One is to include athletic events. In the second policy, it has clarified the type of weapons. They added spring air instead of just air gas powered guns, and then they added the clarification of something that will expel a BB pellet or paintball. Those were included into this language. Those are the only changes from the current policy that I have. I don't think they are mandated by law, no. They were just included as clarification so that it was not just a district sponsored event, but also athletic events. And then because the type of weapons had changed once this had happened, they put that in as clarifying. So it's not law, it's a recommendation from the law.
So we're supposed to expel a student for having their airsoft gun? Okay. I have a problem with that only because I have boys, they have airsoft, and they do want to take it to their friend's house. Now, I don't generally send them from the school to their friend's house, but any kid that's going over to another kid's house, if he has his airsoft in his backpack, because that's what they're going to do, because that's what kids do. I don't think you should be expelling them for something like that. That's crazy.
That was in there before. The only change was spring.
So right.
Right. Well, actually,
and the BB pellet or paintballs is on there too. And
well, I know you're talking about airsoft. Sorry.
Airsoft is BB pellets, and
I don't think this is a bad policy for us, but it does. It does not comply with the new state law that was signed on May 12.
This is for students only.
Right, and it says that for minors possessing airsoft guns, the definition of weapons within a weapons-free school zone, they wanted it to include pneumatic guns, but it doesn't necessarily. And so, while that's something that we can expel a student for, and if it gets any further than us, that if we're thinking that that student would be prosecuted and they're not, we may have to backtrack on our expulsion and reinstate that student. Just so we know that, to be clear, with our policy.
Correct. These changes that were recommended, Pam's correct, these are not pursuant to law. This is recommended changes from the law.
I think we should take it out.
Which part?
I just want to make sure.
Actually, I don't have a problem with leaving it in there because I don't think, I think a student should be aware and that if they are familiar with firearms, no matter what it is, an airsoft gun, paintball, whatever it is, that there's a place for it and it's not school. And so each situation has to be looked at individually.
And I guess I should have clarified and I did not. This policy does not say that they would be automatically expelled. It's saying that we prohibit them from possessing it. Pam is correct in the fact that each individual case would be with that. If it's not an automatic expulsion.
Can I just...
Please, go ahead.
I completely don't understand what Mary's point is, because kids often will go home on the bus with another student, and maybe, I mean, that I was aware, kids are growing up, they use these a lot.
Maybe they have a car.
Yeah, and so, there's a piece of me that's like, this is part of, we're all left to remember when we go through this like a rite of passage for kids. And there's a part of me that keeps saying, what, I get what's going on in the world, but what part of not letting kids be kids can we keep doing? So maybe in this particular instance, just like we require kids to have a note from their parents to go home on a bus that's not their own, perhaps they could have a note that says, Johnny's going to Charlie's house, and maybe he's got to get out of his backpack, and blah, 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 blah.
I guess that concerns me a little bit, because of the fact that, I'm going to date myself a little, but back when I was younger and these types of guns existed, it was very clear what was real and what was not real. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that may open us up for a child who has one of these guns in their backpack, causing extreme terror amongst people, proving they have it and it's not real.
True.
As Pam pointed out, this doesn't lock us into automatic expulsion, et cetera. What it's saying is, we are saying, we are prohibiting you from bringing it to school. We have not specified in policy that it is an automatic X, Y, or Z that happens. So it could still be looked at in an individual case. I would just be very hesitant as a former teacher and administrator of allowing anyone to bring that in.
And I get that. Because seriously, like, unless it's got that nice big orange chip on it that it used to have, you can't tell anymore. I mean, even police officers are getting in trouble around this because you cannot tell, and you do not have the opportunity to take 2.5 more seconds to decide, is this friend or foe?
I get that.
So the guns of any type whatsoever, does that include like showing your lunch food into the shape of a gun? I know you sort of smile here, but that's where we've gone, seriously. That's really where we've gone. So
I would say we should not probably put that in our definition.
I'm seriously, I mean, a kindergarten kid chewing his popcorn into the shape of a gun, or like I point my finger because this is what kids do. We cannot be expelling them or, you know, pulling out of school. That's crazy.
So, can someone clarify for me which part of the state?
I don't have a problem.
I don't have a problem with this. I think our parents, you know, exposing our other students, if I was a parent of a child attending school, I wouldn't want these anywhere near the property if possible. And I think that's an expectation. I think it still allows us the flexibility to respond appropriately, but this is, sets an expectation that you're not bringing these on school property. I'm fine with that. I'm not saying you take immediate action with a student, but boy, I don't think
I mean, maybe it could be if we're worried about, you know, a kid in the state and they bring something to school, because the new law specifically says airsoft guns, such as paintballs, BB guns, or pellet guns will no longer qualify as firearms under state law. That was signed in May. But there's also a stipulation in there about brandishing. There's a difference if a student who's in whatever, Cub Scouts, whatever, sticks in his backpack, totally forgets, ends up bringing it to school, and it's in his backpack and he forgot, and that can be genuinely, you know, figured out by a principal, as opposed to a student who's brandishing an airsoft gun in school, you know, causing extreme distress to students or staff. So maybe this is something that we need to clarify.
I like the fact that the board still has discretion to see something individually. Some of this committee over the years, when Jack Carl was on this committee, when we started having some of these issues, he saw it from a police perspective. And knew that there was many times he was in, you know, he saw the gray area that we sometimes, you know, the state is sort of taken away from us in a way, zero tolerance on some things. And I think of one, you know, where we have some special education kids who would rather be taken advantage of, who were set up, and, you know, they were going to be the victims twice, you know. So I like the fact that we can look at it case by case, that the board has a chance to, you know, have a last say.
I do think that we always have the ability to look at intent, like Pam said, brandishing and intent.
co-agree with Don in the fact that a BB gun, a pellet gun, or a paintball gun, I mean, it still can cause harm.
Oh, yeah.
And we don't make exceptions for people to bring pocket knives. So I guess that we would just have to really look at that when we talk about, this says knives, we're not saying, well, you could bring your Swiss Army knife, but, you know, so I guess that some kind of sends a confusing message to our kids if we're going to, you know, say, oh, okay, well, we didn't specify this, but if we leave it out, we still could, you know, it still says air powered.
Okay, I'm looking for consensus. I heard some objection to this. Is there consensus to approve this as is? I'm looking down one side of the table. Yes. No, maybe, and no response. Okay, there's enough to say yes, we're moving on.
Okay, this is my last one, and then I have a second break, and then I have the other 10.
Okay, so student fundraising, 5830. This is in response to the state, federal, the guidelines about the smart snacks that you changed, I believe, 2 years ago, 2 times ago. Now they've decided that we can do it. So the changes that you see are changes recommended from NEOLA, as well as, I believe, it's referenced at the end. The law that's at the end, so we've had some changes to this. They at first came out and said, no way, no how, can you have any fundraisers? You can't sell bagels, you can't do that because it doesn't meet the smart snacks. Now they're saying, this is a recommendation from NEOLA and administration because they had much more restrictive language that said we wouldn't allow any fundraisers, period. We got feedback from our principals when they knew this law changed that said, please, like, you're not allowing us to do bagels or anything like that. So the recommendation is that we would have, this is as lenient as it gets. It's either basically no fundraisers, or we could permit 2 fundraisers per week of the items that are an exception to the current smart snacks. And then other than any non-compliant fundraisers, they still have to be in the smart snacks, so we aren't, you know, violating that completely. The other changes, the things that are crossed out, are the things that have changed in the law. And then on the second page, these are just some clarifications, and we changed the policy numbers that are there about fundraising. So this is all about smart snacks and how restrictive it was. They have released it a little tiny bit for us to at least, for example, we aren't selling like monster drinks and things like that. This is things like bagels, that we weren't allowed to have bagel scales because it didn't meet the smart snack guidelines. So this is a combination of recommendations from NEOLA and administration, and I can tell you that we tried to choose something that was much less restrictive than what we had. This is like why we feel like you get 2 fundraisers a week.
Lisa, I only have one question. On page 2 or 3 or 3 or 3, are these changes being made? They're not bolded, they're shaded. Is that just a typo?
Things that are crossed out.
Advisors for approved school organizations shall not accept. Is that a change?
Well, don't they know?
Or are they new, or what are they?
While she's looking for that, I will tell you that we ran into trouble because previously we said if it's bolded, it's new. But NEOLA had stuff that was bolded, so then you couldn't really assume that anymore. Because just because it was bold, it may be just as part of it. So then we went to, if it's shaded, it's new. Page 2 or 3, Lisa, you see how it's shaded, but it's not bold?
Somehow, I have 2 policies mixed together, so that's why I'm...
Oh, I see, the bottom of...
Yeah. Out of 2 and then top of 3.
Correct, except that I got my pages out of order.
Yeah, there you go.
On page 54.
Right, I'm trying to figure out what that is.
Oh,
okay. That was new. It was supposed to be bolded. That was our mistake. It is new.
So, that's from the NEOLA?
Yes. And this goes along with the For example, I am the student council rep, I'm a student council teacher, and I am not allowed to, if three people come from organizations, the bagel people, the sucker people, and the candy people, I cannot take any compensation from them. Like, they can't pay me to make sure that I choose their bagels.
Ken? Thank you.
Yeah, I have one quick question.
Sure.
On page 203, the second paragraph.
Okay.
Fundraising by students on behalf of those school-related organizations and district support organizations whose funds are not managed by the district, because the prior was funds managed by the district. This one says, not managed by the district may be permitted on or off school grounds by the superintendent or designee. Are they also limited to two a week per school?
Yeah, they still have to follow these. They still have to follow our guidelines for fundraisers.
Can I ask you about booster groups?
With their own 501c2.
Yeah.
It's different.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
They are not a school group.
All right.
Not a school group.
I think we're fine with that.
Okay, so we're good with that.
Okay.
Okay.
So now we're moving on to
Rachel. Right for me, yes.
Okay, now remember, we get to assume that these have all been addressed, so, right, there's speed and so on.
Right. All right, so this is going to take a break. I have a couple policies, and this was mentioned, I believe, when we were doing the bylaws about some changes in the federal requirements, and this is from the Office of Management and Budget. Uniform administrative requirements, cost principles, and audit requirements for federal audits. So I'm going to go a little bit out of order, and I apologize, but I have about four policies that come under that umbrella. I want to go through them. The first one is 6110, which is up on, if you're following along, it's on page 56, if you go to page 3. These are all things that we are required to do if we're going to be recipients of federal funds, which we are recipients, and I'm happy to say we are currently doing all these changes, what's been recommended. We're already doing that, everything on page 3, which is item A. Item D, where it's in bold comparison of expenditures and budget accounts, amounts of each award. Item E, and then the cost principles, which is at the bottom of page 3 and goes on to page 4.
The only thing I get on this, again, it's formatting, I'm sorry, but looking at page 404, just remove that space.
Yes.
Okay.
We can do that.
That's it. I read my policy.
And then the next policy, this is a brand new policy, it's 6111, and this is with internal controls, and we're required to have, in order to receive federal funds, an internal control policy. So this is what's being recommended by NEOLA to meet the guidelines put out by the Office of Budget Management.
Yes, I have a question on the very first part. We don't usually see the last line of the first paragraph. Internal controls integrated framework issued by the Committee of Sponsoring Organizations of the Troy Way Commission. Is this required? I mean, I'm not used to seeing this. In looking up the Treadway Commission, there's some other entity. To reference another commission is somewhat unusual.
Yes, it is. I can double check on that, but I believe this was all recorded, but let me just double check it.
I would appreciate it.
The next one is policy 6320, which is purchasing.
And I'm sorry, I said that. Is there any other, does anybody have any objection to holding, waiting for the design on that?
No, good call.
No objection. Okay, here's that.
The next one is purchasing. Again, we actually have some verbiage, so new language is at the front. It's just talking about the procurement of materials and supplies paid for by district funds. And it shall be made in accordance with all applicable federal and state statutes. They talk about it that transactions have to be encouraged in full and open competition. And they talk about good administrative practices and sound business judgments. And then on the second page, they added a bid protest. So if we have anyone that, let's say we had a competitive bid and we had a protest that they didn't agree with the results, these are the regular, I should say, the list
steps they would need to file to go ahead and file a protest. So that is what's new in this policy.
I have a question. When bids go out, are they provided with our, a policy like this so that they understand the way it's supposed to operate and that they have rights, this right to bid protest?
Well, being this is new, we haven't issued any RFP since this is, again, this isn't in our current board policy, but once it is, we would have to put that language in there. I think what we say right now is we have the ability to reject bids and all whatnot. There isn't anything specifically in ours regarding a bid protest. So we would have to, once you approve this policy, we would go in bids going out. After that, we have to include this.
Okay, so when we either accept or deny, we would provide them with our policy and the process?
I would probably put it right into the RFP document so they know right up front.
Okay. Because I would want them not to know that they
were. Correct.
Okay.
So this doesn't say that, it says that the board will be notified of a protest, but it doesn't give a time frame. Can we add a time frame, 10 days in there, for the superintendent to notify the board of a protest? Just because it's frequent that we won't know about a protest until months after the fact. And I personally would like to know about it before I have to be asked about it by somebody else.
We've had some discussion on this. Is there a consensus to accept this as is, or consensus to modify it?
I think consensus of the idea that the board should be notified of the process has been requested or submitted on a bid. I mean, also it's responsible for going out bids. So if A, B, and C bid on something and C gets it, but B thinks that their price and theirs is better, and if they were overlooked, they can file whatever kind of protest they want. But the thing's going to go to some board to solve this, but we as board members should know that this is occurring.
Well, does the fact that it says in here within 5 days of receipt of the protest, the superintendent or designee shall review the protest as submitted and render a decision regarding the merits of the protest, blah, blah, blah. So there's already kind of a...
But the board, it doesn't say the board is...
I realize I'm not finished. Okay. So we already have a time frame in here for the superintendent to look at it, review the merits, and then make a decision. So it shouldn't be too difficult to then say, there's a time frame after that. Maybe I don't know what we consider a reasonable time because I don't know what would be involved in reviewing the merits of it, but would another 5 days be reasonable? Or maybe 10?
Or when?
I mean, there's already a notification.
I think if somebody goes to the effort to actually put in a protest. If somebody actually goes to the trouble of putting in a protest, then certainly, we should know about it.
Well, let's see, we're supposed to be at time, so yeah. We're supposed to be the fiscal controls here.
And if the superintendent has 5 days to make a decision, then if they're actually making a decision in 5 days, then, I mean, I don't understand why we can't shoot off the same email to the board of education that same time frame.
You know, we have standard communication practices, and the idea of any kind of a policy where we're going to shoot off something after the fact, I would just caution, let's keep things within our formal processes, because when you have kind of, you know, random offshoots, that's how things get missed. I mean, let's keep things within our formal processes, because that's how we make sure that we get...
We don't have a formal process, I think.
We provide writing every week, unless there's a short week. So we have a formal process that's been in place for 3 years.
Well, Friday notes is not a formal process in policy, though. So if somebody's going to go to the trouble of, you know, actually making a protest, and it doesn't, it's not a small process. I mean, you have to actually write a letter, and they have to go ahead and produce the information. I mean, they have to actually put effort into it, so if they're going to put effort into it, I think we need it too. I mean, it's just, it can be as simple as a forwarded email to the board of education. That's why I
have to say, there's a protest on this subject, more to follow.
Yeah.
Well, if the superintendent has
has to render a decision within 5 days, there's no reason that the board can't be notified.
I think the superintendent mentioned that if we start making HUD reporting requirements that obligate procedure, it adds something to the complexity. I think Ken, I've been involved with purchasing and sat through a number of times where people weren't happy with the end results of the bid. I think this is micromanaging. I think this is getting involved with day-to-day operations that we expect professionals to handle. And if it becomes a problem, it will come to us. This is day-to-day operations. We don't make these decisions day-to-day. And I think we're overstepping. If it becomes a problem, we'll hear about it. That's my opinion.
So there's already a time frame on for the superintendent.
Pardon me?
And is it that you don't feel that the board should be informed if there's somebody that actually goes to the...
Well, I think the board is overstepping their responsibility on day-to-day operations. That's how I feel.
It's not day-to-day operations.
We could be informed on virtually everything that happens in the district. And this is a day-to-day operation that professionals handle. We should treat them like professionals and expect that they'll conduct themselves accordingly. And this isn't our job.
It's a new policy, and it is, I mean, the bid process is defined by the law. So if someone coming forward thinking that somehow our district's violated that bid process, I think it's important enough that we should know about it. It's not someone coming forward and saying,
And if it becomes an issue, the law will handle it.
Yeah.
Okay, let's get to consensus and see if people want to accept this as stands or change. So I'll first ask, do we want to accept this as written? I'm looking down at mom. Yes? No?
I don't see any reason why it couldn't be put in Friday notes.
I think Friday notes is fine.
But once again, in policy, we're writing policy for future boards. Not every superintendent is going to
How about Friday notes. Just say that the superintendent notifies the board. Right now, it would be through Friday notes.
Right.
If 5 years from now, that superintendent and that board wants an email, then it can be through email. Just make a note that the board will be notified of any bid protest by the superintendent as soon as the superintendent is alerted to the protest. And we don't need to tell the board or tell the superintendent how that needs to be done.
That's true.
Because we should not get involved in that rectifying the protest. That is day-to-day micromanagement that we do not do.
But what Pam says, for future boards or any board, Friday notes is Jackie's way of...
Well, that's what I'm saying. Just make it very broad that the superintendent will notify the board of a board protest.
Period.
How they do it is how they do it.
And that's already there.
So that's your...
It's already in there. Exactly like that.
Okay, so I'm looking down this side of it. You're looking like Friday notes or the boardroom, the superintendent will inform. Is that what that seemed to be what Amy was in?
If it's my degree,
I guess I would just like to suggest that we just have a more reasonable time. Yes. I think that there might not be a full understanding of the day-to-day jobs that we have. And I know that this board wants to make sure that the first thing we do is address the needs of students and staff. So I would just suggest a little bit more reasonable timeline for notifications of these types.
But in this policy, it says within 5 days of receipt of a protest, the superintendent or designee shall review the protest as submitted and render a decision regarding the merits of the protest. So there's no reason if you have to, whoever the superintendent is, has to render a decision within 5 days according to this policy, there's no reason that at that same time the board is not notified.
The only thing I would say is I do, and I would imagine future superintendents would appreciate an opportunity to develop something in some situations where it's messy, that kind of explains what's going on. And if I have to, and I'm just suggesting that maybe making that the very first priority, I would just go back to, I'm not sure that there's a realistic understanding of the day-to-day work and the priorities.
So, but if it's
something that must be done drop everything. This is the most important thing to be done immediately after rendering the decision. I don't think so.
So if you're rendering a decision, does it have to be reinterpreted through the board? I don't understand.
And it'd be the exact same.
If you're rendering a decision, why can it not also be delivered to the board? Does it need to be reinterpreted somehow so that we're getting different information?
Well, I don't know.
What's wrong with this? A protest comes in on Tuesday. The superintendent has 5 days to do it. Whoever the superintendent may make the decision the next day, they may deal with that protest right away. Using our current position on Friday, we get a Friday note. What would be wrong with our current superintendent writing, there was a bid protest, it was resolved, we moved on?
Nobody's asking for more than that.
Okay, then that's all we need to do.
But Jenny's saying she can't do it.
No, we don't expect, though, at least I don't expect, to get an email from Jackie saying there's a bid protest. Tell me about it on Friday notes and that's been handled.
You know, this is not as big a problem, I think, from the day-to-day. We deal with city vendors. Well, during a bond issue like we've gone through, you know, I've sat for 12 years, and we've had lots of these discussions based on bids, and there were lots of reasons why we couldn't accept the lower bid. And, you know, I had been 100 things like that. So, but, you know, Jack is right. Until you've got all the parties involved, you've got, you know, construction crews, management, your own staffing, 5 days could be tough sometimes for her to resolve the situation.
But that's what we have to change. I guess this is what I'm... Then, Jackie, you're saying we need to change that 5 days of receipt of a protest?
But isn't that in the law?
Here's what I'm saying. I don't have experience with the board that you're describing that really wants a one-sentence explanation and then that's good enough. What I have is an experience with board that wants in-depth discussions about the decisions that are made. And what I am saying is if I have 5 days to make that decision and to render an opinion, I might need a little bit more time than to say, to craft the document that explains why, to what I believe will be this board's satisfaction, why that decision was rendered. And I am suggesting to you that getting the decision made in 5 days could be difficult enough. I need more time than to be able to develop the document that fully explains it to what I would expect will be this board's expectation. And there are other operational issues that need to be addressed. So I am not understanding why you guys need to know immediately, like why that has to be the top priority of what we do. So I would just say, put some reasonable amount of time on it. If you want, I will just say, maybe something like 10 days. Something like 10 days.
I'm not saying it's reasonable. Nobody said anything unreasonable. And if you're concerned about time, put your dissertation away for that.
My point is that if there's been a complaint, and I would assume that with the board would be shared before what the complaint was, followed by how you resolve it. Yeah, it was resolved by contacting or,
you know. I'll go back. I think that they're micromanaging. If there's a problem, we'll hear about it. And when it gets to our point, then we'll address it. I think this is a great example of us losing focus on our main mission and goal and trying to run day-to-day operations. I think this is just way overboard. And I think it's a waste of our time. And I think we're really not doing our job, but you know, we got to listen to everybody here. So we floated around with ideas. I heard Friday notes.
The way this is written, and excuse me, Don, but it reads, within 5 days of receipt of a protest, the superintendent of designee shall review the protest as submitted and render a decision regarding the merits of protest and any impact on the acceptance or rejection of the bid, period. Okay, that's the protest, the superintendent's taking care of it in 5 days.
You don't need to know that.
Notice of the filing of a bid protest shall be communicated to the board and shall be so noted in any subsequent recommendation for the acceptance of bid and awarding the contract.
That's good. That's fine.
I mean, it's pretty cut and dry.
I don't know where we should get any more involved than that.
That's right. I mean, it's taken care of.
My concern is finding out about protests after.
Why do you really care?
A bid has been.
It's business. It's business. And I'm proposing that if there's somebody make, I'm proposing that we accept this and move on. If somebody, I'm looking up and down, if they accept, no, you're saying no. Line, yes, yes, no. Sharon?
I just have a comment real quick. I think we're kind of getting hung up on the fact that there was already a 5-day timeframe put in here, so we're all focusing on that. And I think the other issue here is that, not surprisingly, lack of trust. So I don't have a problem with, you know, if the loss is 5 days, fine. Throw a little one-liner in Friday notes, and then, you know, when I first suggested 5 or 10, I don't know how many days.
Page 204, page G, fourth line. think it might be a typo. Total amount of expenses incurred by board members of employees of the district, she had four.
Sure.
All right, the last one that I have is $7,250. And this is a district change on NOLA, and this is just including in our naming and dedication facility policy, the Hall of Distinction honorees.
I was, after reading this, I was wondering if we should include a statement about a nominating process, especially for the Hall of Distinction.
Yeah, so we have a number of things that we could put in administrative guidelines. I mean, that committee created a number of forms to use, you know, in a rating matrix. I know we've got that process, but we should have, I think we just need a little statement in here that there is a process or a nominating petition or something to be.
Okay.
Yes, I think we can, yeah, and yeah. That's reasonable. I think with that modification, then, is it that one? Anybody else?
Agreed.
Agreed, okay.
All right, thank you.
All right. Here we go.
All right, so here at 7530.02, staff use of personal communication devices. Okay. All right, so this is some updates. These are some updates that are actually being recommended by us, and part of it is to just bring us a little bit farther into this century. We are crossing some things out. We are not adding anything. The first thing we are crossing out is the last sentence in the first paragraph, and this is about reading or sending a text message, email, browsing the internet while driving on district time is strictly prohibited. The reason that we're recommending that is taken out is because of the fact that it is also illegal, and so our thought was that we are just reiterating something that already in the law. So we're recommending that removed. The last thing we're recommending be removed on the second page is privacy issues. This says basically that employees cannot use a device to capture, record, do any of these things of students or staff members while attending a school-related activity. This is unenforceable, and it is very silly because of the fact that in our classrooms, we use our phones to capture things all the time, and all of the staff is aware of the requirements of, you know, if somebody is on the no video or the no picture list. If you notice, if you go to a football game or anything that's happening, everybody has their phone up recording, and so this is, it's not enforceable, and this climate that we're in, it's not something we want to say, because, I mean, we capture student work and student performances all the time, so our recommendation is that it's removed.
Good.
All right, the next one, 7540, computer technology and networks. This has to do with more technology and how we're using it. We took out some things that were about the network and the district, as a reference to the district technology plan. The bold on the first page are things to that we would like to add. What was in there before was when you had a district technology plan that you wrote because you were a very advanced district and had a district technology plan. It's now required by the state of Michigan for us to have our TRIG funding. It used to be for E-rate funding, and they keep going back and forth. So rather than having here all this specific about what it's going to do, the recommendation is saying that the procedures will be in the administrative guidelines because we must have a district technology plan as it is. So rather than trying to put every single thing in here that we want our district technology plan, we're saying we're going to have one because we have to have it, and how we're going to implement it would be in the administrative guidelines. The other things that are taken out, if you notice, these are little changes that have to do with social media. The one thing that we took out was instructional staff.
In the past, it said the board authorizes the instructional staff to access social media. We took out the word instructional because of the fact that all staff is doing it. So we can't say, oh, only instructional staff can do this. And we also took out the line that says they must have a legal board and principal. Because as we know, that's not happening. And the other one, it has to do with the same thing with the access and use is approved in advance by the superintendent, his or her, doesn't deserve. Yeah, so those are the recommended changes.
Any discussion? Thank you.
Okay, district webpage 7540.02. We only have a couple of changes that are here. These are changes recommended by NEOLA as NEOLA and as the back of the district technology plan. We do need to have in there a reference to the Children's Online Privacy and Protection Act. It's not a law, but we need to have it because part of the district technology plan says that we do follow these guidelines. So we put it in the policy to say we are going to follow this. We are going to do everything we can to protect our children from these things. It does not limit us from accessing things such as newspaper articles and those types of things. On the second page,
on this first page, you have a double parentheses and a period where I think we shouldn't be
oh,
a period
yeah,
and letter.
I see it. Alrighty, on the second page, this is the addition of the advertisements that we may have advertisements on the district webpage as long as they meet the requirements for the policies that we already have. We also have put in here the prohibition of the fact that the websites cannot have anything to do to support a candidate for a website. It can't link to a website that supports a candidate, and you can't communicate anything to support or oppose labor union interaction. And this is just, it's doing this is what we do as a public school.
Okay, all right.
All right, student education technology acceptable use, 7540.03. These are some, I guess, replacements. So the cross out, and then you see at the top the stuff that we added. This was in conjunction with NEOLA. This was a lot of work on part of administration working with NEOLA as well as trying to update this because our student technology policy was a little outdated for some things. We are mandated to have this policy in order to submit our technology plan for those TRIG grants. This is basically just saying that we do have internet access, we want students to use it, but we do have some policy in line with what they can use it for. We are not saying that we can block out every single bad thing that could happen on the internet, but that we attempt every possible way to do so, and the students understand that when they're on our district provided network, that there are things that are prohibited, and this is communicated out to students so that they are aware of this. Obviously, we can't limit every single thing. You do have to have, for the federal law, we have to have filters and blocks, and on the second page, we just added the more of the definition or the explanation of what that means. We used to just have something that said basically we're going to sort of block these types of things. We replaced it with the language from the Child Internet Protection Act so that we're just consistent with that. So the changes that are in here just bring the policy more up to date to what we're actually doing and the access that we have. What we had before, it was a lot of it was just more restrictive because we didn't have the access that we have now in every single building to every single thing. So we did follow the guidelines from NEOLA as well as making sure that we have everything in there that we need in order to meet the guidelines for getting that trade money.
Any thoughts? Okay.
Okay. The next one is essentially the staff version of the student one. There was quite a bit taken out because of the fact that, which is what I talked about before, some of the stuff that was in here is just no longer valid. It's not now. It made things a little bit broader. specific. We have talked about the fact that, same thing, we're going to block these things, you have access to these things, but you cannot commit any acts while using our technology or our wireless internet that, you know, is against the law. However, it has made it a little less restrictive in the fact that during school time, obviously, we assume that no one's using these services to do something that they shouldn't be doing. However, if you are after school hours, or you're there because, you know, during your lunchtime or whatever, you know, you might go on Amazon. You might, our other policy is very restrictive of the fact that we basically said you can't do that. And we know now that even with our phones connected to our wireless, essentially that is our district technology. And we were trying to say to people, well, during school time, you can't be connecting. So our other policy was just not enforceable. So this is the one that we would move to for staff. Obviously still restrictive to protect things, but not as restrictive.
All right.
And that is all my thoughts.
Wow. Now we're back to you.
And now it's my turn.
Yep.
No.
Now you can go to the other end of the table.
Now we will move on to 9210. This is about parent motor district support organizations. This policy, all of the changes were suggested by NEOLA. The first one that you'll see is in regards to discrimination, stating that district support organizations cannot discriminate based on race, color, national origin, sex, sexual orientation, etc., and that the meeting should be communicated to that school and open to the public. The next that you'll see is item A, and that essentially is saying that if there were some type of accident during one of these organizational meetings, they could not come back and try to use the district's insurance. They would need to have their own insurance. Because NEOLA added A, you'll see that it does change my lettering moving forward. B, C, D, and then E is actually the new F that you see highlighted is replacing the old E that's striped out behind it. And that is in regards to smart SNPs. Like Lisa mentioned earlier, there were changes either last year or year before in regards to fundraising, what kind of snacks we could have, bake sales, things like that, bagel sales, and they've since changed it. And so our new F goes along with the policies that Lisa mentioned earlier, with those two fundraisers per week per school, and they follow the guidelines of the USDA dietary for Americans and stock stamps in schools. And that's it for that one.
Okay. Yep.
And then the very last one is relation with special interest groups. There's one small change in the political interest section. You'll see it highlighted from the very bottom of that page. This is in regards to school facilities or equipment may not be used as a means of producing or disseminating to the community materials and advertising for one's local party, cause, etc., unless approved by the superintendent or designee as compliance with the law. And this was added just based off of going back through all of our policies and seeing that we missed this the first time and has been approved by NEOLA.
Any questions? All right.
One second, hold on. I did read through this first. Okay, thank you.
All right. Where are we? Okay. 97?
Done.
You're done. Okay. All right, we're good. We have in front of us, as we go about this two different ways, I believe we had four different policies that we asked for additional information or some modification to. There are 0140 compensation, 5114 foreign exchange students, 5460 graduation requirements, and 6111 vendor relations. Our options are to ask to, because this is a two-step process, to approve these as they stand, and then expect the next time for them to come back with modifications where we can reject them. Or we can pull those off for tonight. That's why you do policy and stuff in a two-step section. But I have a question, yeah.
I just have a question because So if it's just a formatting change, that's a clarification?
Yeah, that I don't think was one of the ones.
Oh, you should read that one.
I did, well, there was something.
The foreign student one was just.
It was just formatted?
That's all I have.
Okay, then that's, all right, I'm sorry. Then, okay, that was 5114. All right, so we have three. Would you consider a motion to accept these, understanding that we will revisit these for final approval? Or do we need to pull those? Any thoughts?
I make a motion.
Go ahead.
I make a motion that we approve the first reading of all of the policies tonight, with the exception of, read all that were.
Well, with the exception of 0140 compensation, 5460 graduation requirements, and 6111 vendor relations.
I'll support that.
Okay, we have a motion. Is there any discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Nay.
Okay, motion carries. Thank you. Next on our agenda is curriculum and office.
About sending students to the Providence Center? You just did pull that now? Actually, I was just going to say that.
I'm sorry, did I just?
You said it the first time.
Yeah.
But then when you made, just now when you did the final motion.
Okay.
So which one is that?
It's 5610.
5610.
Are we making a motion to?
Correct, that's the Providence Center.
Okay.
I'm sorry, the number again?
5610.
So there's four of them?
No, yes, I'm sorry, yes, sir. Okay, so it's amended, and that was a second by Bob, and all in favor? Aye. Okay, opposed?
Nay.
Okay, motion carries again, sorry. Let's see, curriculum instruction office, data dashboard and.
Okay. Okay, the only thing that I have is I just wanted to let you know, on the data dashboard, we have finally unembargoed, I'm not sure that's the word, released the ACT scores from the state, and so that data has been updated to be included here. So that in a week, not last Friday, but Friday before, we wrote a Friday note about the ACT scores, and so this, all of this was just, now the data dashboard is in its proper home on the data dashboard, same information as the Friday note.
Yes, but also, I mean, just to elaborate, that you'll see that the ACT scores look very good when you look at them in comparison to the state and county. We are right, you know, we always want to do better, but we are in a very good place. Our traditional high schools, 14, 15, is 20, are coming at 20.1 in comparison to the year before at 19.9. So a 0.2 increase is a huge percentage increase.
It is at that level of the scale, because as you move up the scale, it's harder to increase. And of course, with the spring, we take the SAT, so the comparison will be easy.
And the two traditional high schools are also above the state and county averages, so that's something we're proud of as well.
So has our public relations department done anything with that?
Not yet, none of the relations are released.
Yeah, we have been released by the state, but we haven't been.
Well, we can't, we talk about ourselves, we're still missing.
So we have a press release ready to go?
We don't have one today, Mary, but I will have one.
But we had one right the morning after for schools of choice.
Okay, thank you for the presentation. Now, next to non-business office report on homestead millage election.
Yes, back in September, actually in September, at the September 8th board meeting, we had a resolution to support the millage initiative on March 8th ballot, and that was approved. The resolution included two separate proposals. The first proposal was for the renewal of 18.532 mills. The second one was a proposal for an additional 1.0 mills. Subsequent to the board approval, we've been advised to eliminate the proposal for the 1.0 mills. As preliminary inquiries indicate that it may not pass and may negatively impact the 18 mills that we have up. So what we have for tonight for approval is a new resolution that only has the 18.532 mils, and that is what is attached to this document. So administration recommends the board motion to adopt the resolution as presented for the operating millage on March 2016 election.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
And board member Hoover, is there a second?
I'll second it.
Board member Servio, is there any discussion on the motion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Thank you very much. Human resources?
I just want to mention that Mike is ill today and yeah. has been ill most of the week. So Bob Lenhart is going to be taking the acting as Mike.
Thank you.
He was on the negotiating team.
Members of the Lions Crews Administration Association ratified that tentative agreement as negotiated with us and administrated. Both Mr. Van Camp and I want to thank the LCAA bargaining team for its honest and frank approach throughout our negotiations. So the administration recommends the Board of Education to approve the TA as presented.
Well, is there a motion?
I make a motion that we approve the tentative agreement between Lance Crews Board of Education and the LCAA, which is the Lance Crews Administrators Association, as submitted.
Is there a second?
I'll support it.
Board Member Hoover, you have a motion and a second. Any discussion on the motion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Thank you very much for your work. Thanks, Mike, for us too, and the officers and the people that we had the opportunity to work with. I appreciate that. Is there anything else? It's been brought to my attention, I'm not Sharon, I'm not sure. We have a number of items. One of the things I'm moving on to unfinished business. That some of the items that when we deleted employment recommendations, I understand there may be a couple items on there that are problematic, but we have a lot of items on that item that may be probably, again, time frame wise, to present some consequences to employees. And I would entertain, would there be a motion to open that up for discussion or reconsideration, possibly removing any items that were problematic so we can...
Are we on unfinished business?
Yes.
I don't think we can reconsider.
Oh, yes, you can. Actually, under Robert Rules of Order, you can reconsider.
Can you cite Robert Rules of Order for deciding, please?
No, I'm the chair, so we don't have to follow Robert Rules. I'm the chair. That's what we're doing.
Well,
that's what it says.
And
actually, if I would entertain a motion, if somebody wants to do it, if they don't want to bring it up, I'm not. We won't. But we have employees. No, we certainly can because we're the board, and we can do this.
No, which employees would be considered crucial?
I would ask that there be if you want to relate the concerns to that. Is there any?
It needs to be reconsidered. They would wait until next week. They wouldn't be continue being paid the way they're being paid right now.
So we don't, for example, and I don't want to use a name here, but let's just say we had a clerical person that was moving up to a different job and got promoted. They're at that rate of pay where they were at, and they really aren't supposed to transfer duties until the day after the board. Typically, it has an effective date until that day. So for example, under non-instructional, on line number 3, that individual should be able to really, in essence, take over the bad duties or they get that rate until this was approved.
But you've already put it in place, and now it's an emergency on my part? Because, I mean, you never know what's going to happen at this board table. So now suddenly it's an emergency on our part. But you've already put this person in a position without board approval.
Well, I'm not the HR person. So
I just, not you in general, but.
Yeah, I know what you're saying.
So, and now suddenly it's an emergency on our part and we're going to, it's my understanding from every other board I've ever witnessed that anything that doesn't pass has to be moved to the next meeting for reconsideration.
So we also have things on there.
I haven't heard a motion, so if I don't hear a motion, we won't act on it.
You have things on here since September that all of a sudden are in emergency. It doesn't seem reasonable.
I would hope that people would treat these in consideration. Go ahead, Karen.
I fail to see whether it comes to keep this as emergency for the board tonight or not. I fail to see why this board cannot do employment recommendations.
Right. So would you put that in the form of a motion to reopen discussion on, this was what number, H1?
I move that we reopen discussions on H1 with employment recommendations. I move that this board does the job of this board.
Is there a second?
We did the job of this board earlier when it was voted down.
I was asking if there a second. I'll second that motion.
We're going to vote down this many employment recommendations?
We already did it, and now we're reconsidering it during the meeting when you shouldn't be reconsidering it until the next meeting.
Well, it's just Monday.
You don't get to keep re-voting on stuff that gets voted down.
Actually, we can.
No, you can't.
Well, that's what we're doing. I just heard a motion in a second.
So if you don't get what you want, you just keep asking and keep asking and keep asking?
I'm usually not the repetitive one.
If mom says no, you ask dad, and if dad says no, you ask uncle, and if uncle says no, you ask aunt, and if aunt says no, you ask grandma.
Pam, please, can you not be a smart aleck?
And that's why we're asking the board.
So I can look at this, please, because I don't want to do something
wrong. No, I don't have Robert's rules in front of me, but I can reference our board of commissioners at the county level.
Well, we're not that, and we don't follow Robert's rules.
So we vote something down, and we continue to revisit it until it passes, and you get what you want? I don't understand.
No.
So you're not following the will of the board.
If you would listen for a second, another board member.
He's not respecting the decision of the board.
All right. As I said, there were some items on there that were problematic. And those items could be withdrawn upon discussion.
Does the operating procedure say that a decision made by the board will be respected?
No, but
the decision is already made.
Now, I personally believe that that motion caused confusion among the board. I was not voting for what this turned out to be. And I feel we owe it, I agree with my colleague, that we owe it to do the board's. I really feel that the way that was handled, it just caused confusion up and down the line. It was early in the agenda. I think the employees have a right, you know, at least let's have a chance to vote on it, and if, you know, then we have to bring it back.
Well, would there be, now we have a motion and a second, there's discussion. Would there be items that board members would want to withdraw from the employment recommendation?
Yeah, maybe that, I'll get to that. Let's withdraw what might be an issue.
The motion to discuss it was not seconded. Everybody had an opportunity to go ahead and discuss it.
It was to vote on it,
and it was not seconded.
I'm sorry, this motion was seconded.
It was not.
The original motion was not seconded, and you said it failed because there was no second.
Okay, now we have a motion on the board that there is a motion and a second.
But you can't go back and keep doing something just because you didn't get the desired outcome.
No, I'm not looking for a desired outcome.
You want to?
I'm looking to do the business of the board. And I understand that there are some issues here that are problematic. I'm suggesting that if they are problematic, remove them from this item, and we can move on where we don't hurt other people.
We're not hurting anybody. And that opportunity, it didn't happen. It needs to be moved forward to the next meeting.
Well, we have a motion and a second. If nobody wants to withdraw anything from this, we'll go ahead and proceed with the vote. Is there a request for a vote? You can't do that.
Are you saying that if there's an item on this part of the H1 that we want withdrawn?
Sure.
Then can we make a motion while a motion is being made?
You can make, there's this part of discussion, and we could ask for them to withdraw those items if you want. That's where we're at. We're discussing.
I think we should withdraw the technology supervisor decision for further discussion.
And what number is that? Ida on the list? Number five.
Not instructional five.
Now we have a motion and a second. Is there anything else that that people would ask to have withdrawn?
Ben, you're doing it wrong. You know it.
Thank you. Okay. I believe that you made the original motion. You accept. Remove non-instructional five.
Sharon
made the second. Would you accept to remove non-instructional five from the motion?
Then I make the
that you made, I think Ken made the...
Actually, Chair made the motion.
Oh, I'm sorry, you made the first, you would accept it?
Yes.
And Ken would accept it?
Yep.
So, we have a motion to approve the employment recommendation with removing non-instructional five from the employment recommendation. Is there discussion?
I'm sorry.
Yeah, go ahead.
There, this proposal for this recommendation includes four positions that are linked as part of the technology reorganization. To remove one and leave the other three on is not right. I know I would say to you, I guess I would like to have an opportunity to talk about why administration is recommending this. But if we're not going to do it tonight, it feels, I can't understand a process where one name would be removed and the other three would stay.
We have a motion on the floor.
And there's this great discussion.
And we're in discussion.
Right.
So if we don't want to discuss it tonight, then we need to vote down this motion. And bring it back on a week from tonight.
Sharon?
I just want clarification, since I was not here in the last meeting. Did not this same thing happen last week? So are we going to pump this for the third meeting now?
It was off the agenda.
Mrs. Ross is speaking, please. So the last meeting, when I wasn't here, it went off the agenda. It looks like it's supposed to go off the agenda tonight, which means it will go to the third board meeting. So if this is such a contentious issue, instead of punting, why don't we discuss and get it over with?
Because it's 11 o'clock at night and some of us have to be up for work at 5 a.m.
Then we need to stop complaining about crap. We should be complaining about get down to the business of this stuff. And I don't really care if we skip the morning because I think everyone in this room needs to get up in the morning. Mary, I'm talking.
I heard you.
Then shush your face. Please. I said shush your face, please. Twice I said it. It's done, okay? We either get this stuff finished or we don't. We cannot keep punting this stuff down the road.
The difference is the this was voted on earlier in the meeting.
Fine.
So the business was finished.
That's not what I voted on.
It was not.
But it is what you voted on. Whether it was confusing or not, it's what you voted on.
That's what she did.
Okay.
We have a vote.
Number one.
So the point still is, we want to keep punting this down the road. At some point, there has to be a discussion. We can't just say, I want to take it off the consent agenda. I want to take it off the employment recommendations. We have to do something. We can't not like and keep doing this without doing whatever we need to do.
The board did not remove it from the last agenda.
What happened to the last
Mrs.
agenda?
Mrs. Johnson removed it from the last agenda. So the board had no
opportunity. Oh, I'm not talking about who
did. No, it was not the total employment recommendation.
Right.
It was just specific recommendations, individual recommendations.
So we still have to get to the point where we need to address this, do we not?
Yeah, well,
can I make
this has been added, it's gotten confusing enough. Hearing that from Sharon, who made the original motion, and the superintendent. Pardon, go ahead.
Prior to the change to having two meetings a month, this
don't
was
swear at me, Mary. Don't do that.
Excuse me, you're interrupting me.
She's swearing at me now at the clock.
I'm sorry. It's not what I'm being used.
Yes, actually.
All right. I'm sorry. Point of order. We expect that foul language will not be used. As a board, we agree upon that. And I would ask that board members refrain from using language.